Welcome back to the channel, everybody. In this video, we're going to be looking at the Unibody MacBook Pros, and we're going to discover why it's still a very viable option for a lot of people even today. We're going to be looking at which year in particular is the best year to buy the Unibody MacBook Pro. Hint, it's in the title. And finally, we're going to be seeing which one upgrade completely transforms this MacBook and makes it a really fantastic bit of kit. Let's get into it. So anybody that saw my first video will notice that I've changed my desktop from horrible orange wallpaper that I was using to cover the top of my desk with now this nice grey, sort of vaguely modern looking pattern. So what I've got in front of me are a MacBook Pro 2012 and my MacBook Pro 2015 Retina. Let's open the 12 and let's open the Retina. So the reason that this 2012 MacBook Pro is actually still quite a find is because it was the last MacBook to have user upgradeable parts. It actually had some parts that you could just buy off the shelf. They were fairly standard sort of laptop parts, and those parts were the RAM inside this. Again, you can buy that off the shelf, you can get it from Amazon, and the SSD slash HDD, hard disk drive, you can buy from Amazon, and you can change them yourself quite easily actually. The battery in it as well, also, you can buy replacements. They wouldn't be original Apple replacements, but you can buy Chinese replacements, that sort of thing. By 2015, they upgraded this in 13, by the way, to this model here, which I've got the 2015 model. The battery was glued to the top case of the laptop, so you couldn't take it out very easily at all without, like, cheese wire, essentially, to try and get it off the case, and it just, it can cause a real mess and real hassle to try and get the battery out if you wanted to change it. You couldn't change the RAM at all. That was soldered onto the motherboard, and the hard drive, or the solid state drive, it's possible to change it, but for a long time after it came out, it wasn't really a sort of off-the-shelf part. There's now actually quite a few sort of ones you can do your own hard drive upgrade with. But yeah, when it first came out, people weren't so sure about it. And the reason that Apple made this change between the 12 and the 13 slash now 15 is that they wanted to make the laptop thinner. You can see the difference in thickness between this laptop here and this here. And by actually soldering the RAM onto the motherboard and gluing the battery down and going for a hard drive that wasn't a physical hard drive, it's probably about this sort of size within the 12, we'll see it later. The hard drive in the 15 or 13 onwards is probably like this sort of size. And it's really, really, really thin, and it just sits onto the motherboard and actually plugs directly in, so it is faster than the very limiting SATA III connection that you use to connect the SSD in here. You would expect the last of the Unibody MacBook Pros to be the best, of course, but actually the spec bump between the 2011 MacBook Pro and the 2012 MacBook Pro was extra significant. The first difference is that the 2012 got Ivy Bridge processors. That last little jump on the last year of the Unibodies was really important. A smaller spec bump is that the 2012 got 1600 megahertz RAM, whereas the year before they were running 1333 megahertz RAM. 1333, not the number of the devil, the number of half a devil. But actually the difference between the 1600 RAM and the 1333 RAM won't actually make that much of a difference in the grand scheme of things. You won't really notice it. One thing you may notice is the difference in Bluetooth. So the 2012 model was running Bluetooth 4.0, whereas the 2011 was only running Bluetooth 2.1. Again, quite a big jump. And something, 4.0 has still been used in some modern, a lot of modern computers even nowadays. Probably the most important and most exciting spec bump that the 2012 had over the 11 and all the other unibodies is that all of the unibodies up until 2012 were running USB 2.0, which anybody who's used USB 2.0 know, is slow. Whereas USB 3.0 was a real kicker. It was a lot faster than USB 2.0, and the 2012 had it. The true sign of a fantastic Apple device is how long Apple give it software support. So the 2011 MacBook Pro had software support up until macOS High Sierra, whereas the 2012 MacBook Pro had 2 more years of software support. It had macOS Mojave and even got macOS Catalina, which is what this MacBook Pro here is running now. So what is the big upgrade that makes the MacBook Pro 2012 still a very viable option for a lot of people even today? Here's the answer. the hard drive. The hard drive in these computers, as standard, is a physical spinning disk hard disk drive. The difference is that solid state took over after hard disk drives, and solid state is instant. It's flash storage, just like a USB flash drive, and it's very, very quick. Now, the hard disk drives in here are both the death and the redemption for this computer. I'll tell you why. The hard disk drive being so slow means that a lot of people who haven't watched this video or don't know otherwise will sell their old MacBook Pro 2012 very cheaply because they think it's a pile of trash. Because they think, why on earth would I hold onto this MacBook that can't keep up with anything I'm doing in the modern age? So they just upgrade to a newer MacBook. But actually, if you've got the know-how, we already know that the hard drive in this is user serviceable, is user changeable, and it's actually very easy to do. So why wouldn't Apple use SSD hard drives as standard? The price. The price is the main factor. Back in 2012, for the exact same laptop that we got here on the desk, the 256GB solid state option was a $400 option. Whilst we're here, we might as well have a look at the other options on the Apple site back in 2012, so we can see you've got all of your one-to-one services. Oh, and surprise, surprise, lots of dongles. Apple truly are the dongle kings. So over the years, SSD technology has come down in price and improved in performance. And in fact, we've now got to a point where a 2.5-inch SATA III SSD, like we'd find in the MacBook Pro 2012, has got to the point where it physically can't be pushed any further because we got to the maximum amount of throughput through SATA III. So I have bought myself an SSD. So this SSD is the fastest SSD on the market and the fastest you can possibly get for a SATA III connection, like we've got here. It's the Samsung 860 Pro, possibly a little bit of overkill. It costs $90, a lot less than the $400 option that the SSD was in 2012. And actually, this is a lot better technology than you would have bought having the Apple option in 2012. You can definitely get them cheaper than this, but this is the one I've gone for. It can have 4,800 terabytes of data written to it before there may be a problem. So this is covered. For much more than your average Mac user. So we're going to install this and see how we go. I don't know if you can see, but there's a seal right on the top there and a seal on the bottom. We're going to have a go at slicing open the seal on the top, like that. Pop this open. It's in a little plastic tray. Perfect. So in here we get some standard Samsung documentation and we get our SATA SSD drive. I've gone for 256GB because that was one of the options on the original Apple website. Some of the cheaper SSDs that you'll find on Amazon, for example, you might find a 250GB SSD rather than a 256. I'm going to show you just how easy it is to change out the hard disk. I'm going to show you the tools you need, how to do it, and absolutely under no circumstances should you be vacuuming. Whilst we're in here, I can show you a few other things. So why do I need trim, I hear you ask? I'll show you the boot up time of this and compare it to the boot up time that we took beforehand.